Tell me, John, in the last few weeks, I mean, you must have been on the same kind of lockdown, sort of, what is it, like 2 months now, 8 weeks or something, pretty much? Have you managed to get a magazine out in that time?
Yeah, we have. I have no excuses now. Why aren't you at work? It's like, yeah, I can't say I'm somewhere anymore.
I seem to remember. I was just recounting to Myrtle the other night when we walked into Skunk Magazine for maybe the second or third time on that visit. You were sat at your desk, and what had come through was an email from South Africa from weed.coza, from Chris J, because he was writing for Skunk Magazine, and on your screen was a picture of Myrtle and I as we walked in the office. That was a synchronicity trippy thing that went on that moment.
Yeah, Chris J is on the thread watching us live.
I was savvy enough to plan it, you know, it just happened. So.
And then I seem to remember we went out and ate and drank a lot.
What did you do?
Yeah, we went to a friend's house, I remember, I think. Well, we started at a bar, and then we ended somewhere else.
Right, and it's Skunk Magazine. So, could you say now that Skunk Magazine is back to going from strength to strength? I mean, you put so much time and effort and money into it.
Well, but basically, with the last issue was my last as editor-in-chief.
Uh-huh.
I sort of handed off the reins to Julie.
Right.
For a few reasons. One, I'm getting tired of the same thing. Two, the last few years, like I said, took the fun out of it. And for me, in this legal world, the romance is gone. I don't feel like writing about big companies and their stock portfolios and their sham strains and all that. It's you know, I used to enjoy writing about smugglers and outlaws and people that basically risk freedoms to show people how beneficial this plant was.
Corporate cannabis.
And working with the people that are in it. Well, in Canada, it has changes opening up it, but to me, the damage is done. They had such a chance to lead the global revolution of cannabis, and all they did was make it into an industry like any other, led by bankers and shysters and people. Like you look at the Canadian companies now, half of them are going bankrupt. The black market is still the preferred choice of everybody, and they didn't have to do it that way. Could have been much more inclusive. You could have put 100,000 farmers to work, have a central testing facility. Pass your things, you could sell it.
Boom.
Not
exactly.
Try to make a captive market using all these prohibition tactics and the reefer madness in order to just give it to a whole bunch of cronies and friends who put it to the ground, meanwhile exited with, $100 million.
Yeah, no, the Southern Africa the last couple of years have been crawling with their canopy and the rest of it. You know, we've had a hell of a thing. We've had many, many discussions on this show about it, the pros and the cons, because, bottom line is in South Africa, one of the things we maybe need a little bit of is expertise in growing en masse. But that's about it. We've got it pretty well taped with some really expert people around.
We have good farmers.
Yeah, we've got some great farmers around. So.
Huh? It's been growing wild for thousands of years. It's not that difficult to figure out.
That's it.
Exactly.
Well, we can't.
I always said the plant doesn't need protection. Like the plant, we don't need protection from the plant. The plant needs protection from us.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Corporate cannabis just went and took all the fun out of us.
The plant on its own basically is benign and beneficial. It's the companies that basically put these poisons in it that you have to watch out for.
Mm.
The plant itself is perfect.
I seem to remember a number of months ago, John, maybe it's a year ago now, so you, in the last year you were in Greece, you headed off to Europe, and then I think you were going to try your hand at doing something or other in Europe, just for a change. Is that your plans for that? Say again?
We're still in discussion with some groups. We went to Portugal as well, and we got quite far along, but the problem is that a lot of these countries were mesmerized by the promises that these big licensed producers were making. And I actually met with one of the prime minister of Greece at that time, and I told him something that basically was prophetic, in that you'll never see any of this money. The country will never see any of this money that basically these people are promising. And what's happened? The facilities remain unbuilt. Nobody's working. These were just things used to show the stockholders at home that they were getting these multi-million-dollar contracts throughout the world and to buy more of their stock, which is practically worthless. None of these ventures were ever real, because they're headed by people who know nothing about this industry and treating it like any other.
That's it. Failure.
That's what I would tell anybody, any leader in South Africa. all these promises that these companies make are not going to come true.
Mm-mm.
And if they do, it won't be to the betterment of the nation. It will just be to the profit of the company in question.
100%.
Well,
you've seen it in Canada. You're seeing it in California. In California, they're pushing out all the small farmers, you know, in favor of these big conglomerates. You know, it's like business as usual. And I fought all these years for it not to be like that. Maybe naively so, thinking that maybe we had a chance to export the spirit of Canada and the true stewards that were protecting it for all these years and showcasing and highlighting it and showing what it could do to the world. You know, instead of having them included, you know, they're being pushed out. And, you know, for me, it's one of the reasons why I've taken a step back from even cannabis writing. You know, I want to branch out into my own darker psyche, you know, kind of thing. I'm still going to be involved with the magazine, but at the same time, as more of an independent kind of thing.
Okay.
I still have shares in it. But, like, one of the things I'm looking forward to is writing a bit about the history of skunk. Because it's not like we were a typical magazine. We actually became what we were writing about. And it's quite an interesting thing. Maybe we'll do a movie one day. Could be a drama, comedy, horror, or even porn.
And it'll be all four of those. John, I must tell you something funny that's in our live stream here. There's a guy, Michael Muller, is on the thread, and he says, SA guys are getting cravings seeing that cigarette of yours. Because for 2 months now, tobacco's been banned. Tobacco is illegal under lockdown,
Wow.
So there's this massive black market for cigarettes, more so than weed. So you keep tugging on that cigarette and everyone's getting fucking withdrawal and heebie-jeebies watching it.
Well, smoke for all you guys, man.
Thank you.
Wow, you're such a good man.
So
someone, thanks, man. That's so cool of you.
I say these things keep me alive. My body's so toxic that nothing can survive.
John, it's been super cool talking to you, man. It's great to see your face. You will go from strength to strength, I know, and we will see you in your hometown.
Really cool room.
We can't wait to have you here.
Like, to hide all the stuff in the back, you know?
We'll see you in South Africa one day, no doubt. Everyone's going to come here in the end because we're very close to a full kind of trade legalization. I can feel it in my bones in the next year or two. Then you can come and smoke some of the...
Not the place you want to be right now, so maybe I'll take you up on the offer.
Fantastic, Mama. Good to see your face again, John. Thank you, man.
Keep well.
Yes, he's, you know, you and I have written for quite a number of years now. He's double it and go even further back, and he's now looking at stuff that he's written. He's right, though. It's like, it's...
Will you pass me that skunk quick? Let me show it to the Oaks at home. They can get
sure.
an idea.
And it's actually on the front is one of my favourite humans in the whole world as well. That's Jessica Official Violet on Instagram. She's absolutely sexy as fuck. Jessica Official Violet, go check her out. She's a honey, and she's cannabis, and she's gorgeous.
And it's kind of like a High Times of Canada.
It's Canada's High Times, basically, yeah.
But it's the same thing that a lot of, not going to lie, but I guess it's the demograph. Dudes, bongs, and chicks. So.
Well, that's pretty much it. What else do you need? Oh, some ads in the back, some seed offers. But, you know, I see Seven Leaf on the thread. Seven
yep.
Sam's still doing it.
Yes.
And then Extract. I haven't seen much of the Extract. But they're still around, I guess. I don't think anyone's doing any serious publishing at the moment.
Yeah, man. And a quick shout-out to Seven Leaf, eh?
Yeah, Sam, if you're listening, wherever you are, we'll get you in for a Zoom at some point, see how it's going.